please check out the description below for a list of topics I will discuss in this module. Welcome to our fourth module on USMLE Biostatistics, where we will discuss distributions of data. There are two important data types to know for your USMLE exams. First is the categorical or nominal variable. Second is the quantitative variable. In a categorical or nominal variable, we have a finite number of categories without any discrete order, and this is important to know. Examples of categorical or nominal variable include the sex of the patient, which may be categorized as male, female, or other, states in the USA, such as New York, Florida, Texas, or California. Quantitative variables can be discrete or continuous. Discrete quantitative variables only accept whole numbers or values and may have a logical order. An example of this would be defining the diabetes category based on the patient's A1C. So in this case, a patient may be categorized as a non-diabetic if their A1C falls below 5.7. They may be categorized as a pre-diabetic if their A1C is between 5.7 and 6.4. And they may be categorized as a diabetic if their A1C is greater than or equal to 6.5. A continuous quantitative variable accepts any number of values, such as systolic blood pressure of the patient or temperature of the patient. There are three important measures of central tendency to know for your boards: the mean, the median, and the mode. The mean describes the arithmetic average of all the data points in your data set, and it is important to know that the mean is the most affected by outliers or skewed data. The median describes the middle value of the data set. If we have an even number of data points, the average of the two middle values gives the median. And it is important to know that the median is more resistant to outliers compared to the mean. The mode is the most common value in the data set, and it is important to know that the mode is the most resistant to outliers or skewed data compared to the mean or the median. Next, let's talk about skewness. A normal distribution should have a nice symmetric bell-shaped curve such as here, where the mean, the median, and the mode lie on top of one another in the middle of the curve. Extreme values or outliers pull the tail of the graph towards them, creating a skewed distribution. A positively skewed graph is one where the long tail points towards the positive end or positive x values. A negatively skewed graph is one where the long tail points towards the negative end or negative x values. The robustness or resistance of central tendencies towards skewness or outliers is measured by how much the central tendency is pulled towards the skewed tail. In this case, we can see that the mean is pulled most towards the tail, whereas the mode is pulled the least towards the tail. And thus, the mean is considered the least resistant or robust against outliers, whereas the mode is considered the most resistant or robust against outliers. Let's go over an example. Consider the systolic blood pressure readings of a patient over a period of 1 week, and we're given 6 data points, and we're asked to find the mean, the median, and the mode. First, we need to arrange the data points in ascending order, so the lowest value is put first and the maximum value is put last. To calculate the mean, we add up all the data points and divide it by the number of data points, which is 6, and the mean comes out to 99. To calculate the median, since we have an even number of data points, we take the middle two values, add them up, and divide them by 2, and we get 95.5. To get the mode, note that 93 appears twice in the data set more than any other data points, and thus our mode is 93. For your boards, it may be important to know when to use which central tendency. If we have continuous data with a normal distribution, we use the mean. If we have continuous data or ordinal data, which are categorical data that have a natural order, this is important to know, such as age groups, or if we have a skewed distribution, we end up using the median. Now, you may be wondering, why do we use the median for a skewed distribution when the mode is the most resistant or robust? In this case, many useful statistical and analytical techniques have been described with the median rather than the mode, and that's why we use the median. If we have nominal data, which as a reminder are categorical data without a natural order, such as sex or race of the patient, we use the mode or proportions. Moving on to measures of variability and dispersion, the standard deviation describes the dispersion of the study data around its sample mean. It is represented by the Greek symbol sigma, and it is calculated by taking each data point and subtracting the mean of the data set represented by x bar, taking the square of the difference, then adding up those values and dividing by the sample size, which is n minus 1, and finally taking the square root of everything. It is not important to strictly memorize this formula, but it is important to know that as n goes up, or as the sample size goes up, the standard deviation goes down. It is also important to know that like the mean, the standard deviation is also influenced by outliers. Both of these normal shaped graphs here have the mean around 100. However, the standard deviation of the red curve is 10, while the standard deviation of the blue curve is 50. If we have a lot of data points, we may get something like the red curve here with a lower standard deviation and a tighter fit around the mean. Whereas if we have fewer data points, we may get something like the blue curve here with a wider or larger standard deviation and a more spread out curve. The variance is another measure of dispersion around the mean. It is basically calculated by taking the square of the standard deviation. Unsurprisingly, variance is denoted by sigma squared. And the formula for variance is basically the formula for standard deviation without the square root. The standard error around the mean is the deviation of the study sample mean from the true population mean, that is, how closely the sample mean represents the population mean. The standard error around the mean is calculated by taking the standard deviation and dividing it by the square root of the sample size, or n. Thus, the smaller the standard error of the mean, the more closely the sample mean approximates the true population mean. The range of a data set describes the distance between the minimum and the maximum value, and is calculated by taking the maximum value and subtracting the minimum value from it. A percentile describes the value below which a certain percentage of the data falls. As an example, if a value describes the 10th percentile of a data set, this means that 10% of the data falls below this value. A quartile represents 25%, or a quarter of the data set. To measure the quartiles, the data first needs to be arranged in ascending order, that is, from the minimum to the maximum value. The first quartile then represents 0 to 25% of the data set, the second quartile represents 25 to 50% of the data set, etc. A very high yield concept to know for your boards is the interquartile range, which is the range from the second to the third quartile, or from the 25th to the 75th percentile of the data set. The interquartile range assesses the dispersion of the data when the median is used for central tendency. Like the median, the interquartile range is more resistant to outliers and thus is useful when we have a skewed distribution. A normal distribution is represented by a symmetric bell-shaped curve such as shown here, where the mean, the median, and the mode are equivalent and lie in the center of the curve. The 68, 95, and 99.7 rule basically describes that for a normal distribution, around 68% of the dataset should lie within one standard deviation, around 95% of the dataset should lie within two standard deviations, and around 99.7% of the dataset should lie within three standard deviations. The standard normal distribution, also known as the Z distribution, is a normal distribution where the mean is equal to 0 and a standard deviation is equal to 1. Converting normal distributions to the standard normal distribution allows comparison of populations with different means and standard deviations. A Z-score describes how a single data point compares to the mean of the data set. A Z-score of plus 1, 2, or 3 denotes 1, 2, or 3 standard deviation above the mean, respectively. A z-score of negative 1, 2, or 3 denotes 1, 2, or 3 standard deviation below the mean, respectively. Let us run through a quick example. Suppose we have blood glucose measurements from 400 patients with a normal distribution and a mean of around 100. Blood glucose of 120 was greater than 2 standard deviations of the sample. The first question asks us to calculate the standard deviation. In this case, using the z-score formula, if we plug in 2 for z, since 120 was greater than 2 standard deviations, we plug in 120 for x, 100 for the mean or mu, and solve for sigma or the standard deviation here, we will get that sigma is equal to 10. The next question asks us how many patients will have blood glucose less than 80. Using the z-score formula again, if we plug in 80 for x, 100 for mu, and 10 for sigma, we will get z is equal to negative 2. This means that 80 is 2 standard deviations lower than the mean. Using the 68, 95, and 99.7% rule, we know that 95% of the data set should lie within 2 standard deviations, or 5% of the data set lies outside of 2 standard deviations in both of the tails combined. That means each tail should have 2.5% of the data set. Since 80 is less than 2 standard deviations from the mean, that means 2.5% of the patients will have a blood glucose less than 80. 2.5% of 400 is calculated as 2.5 over 100 times 400, which gives us 10 patients. That means that 10 patients will have blood glucose less than 80. In the last slide of the fourth module, let us discuss the concept of regression to the mean. Regression to the mean refers to the phenomena where repeated observations tend to return to their mean value. If we have a mean value here and we keep taking observations, they should be getting closer and closer, closer and closer to their mean value here. In the clinical realm, this prevents overdiagnosis from a single extreme observation. And a prominent example of this can be seen in the diagnosis of hypertension, where elevated blood pressure with repeated measurements in at least 2 readings and on 2 separate occasions must be taken. Imagine the amount of overdiagnosis that would happen if hypertension was diagnosed with only 1 reading. Welcome to our 5th module on USMLE Biostatistics, where we will discuss correlation and regression. The correlation coefficients denoted by R describes the linear association between 2 variables. The word linear is very important here, which basically measures the strength of association between the 2 variables. I'm sure you've heard this all the time, where correlation does not imply causation. Values of R range from negative 1 to 1. The closer the magnitude of R is to absolute value of 1, the stronger the correlation. The positive or the negative sign implies a direction. If the correlation coefficient is positive, both the variables increase or decrease together. If the correlation coefficient is negative, when one variable increases, the other decreases. The figure below shows multiple scatter plots between 2 variables and their respective correlation coefficients. When the correlation coefficient is 0, the best fit line is almost horizontal like this, where an increase in the x variable causes no change in the y variable. As the correlation coefficients go up in magnitude, the relationship between the 2 variables grows stronger, and the points start getting closer and closer to a straight line. Now notice that with positive correlation coefficients, as x increases, y also increases. With the negative correlation coefficients, as x increases, the y decreases. Now remember that the correlation coefficient captures the linear relationship between 2 variables. In the 4 plots here, the calculated R is 0.8. In the first plot, we can see a possible linear relationship between x and y, implying a proper use of the linear correlation coefficient. In the second plot, the relationship between x and y is possibly non-linear or parametric in nature. Thus, using a linear relationship will be improper in this case. The third and fourth scatter plots show the effect of extreme values on the linear relationship. In the third plot here, the linear relationship could look something like this and is being pulled up by the extreme value here. Whereas in the fourth plot, the linear relationship is something like this and is being pulled down by the extreme value here. Thus, it can be important to look at the scatter plots between the 2 variables when we calculate correlation coefficient, so that we can catch possible improper use in a parametric or non-linear relationship, or we can exclude outliers to get a better linear relationship. For regression, the independent variable is often denoted by X, refers to the exposure variable, such as drug dosing, or baseline characteristic variables, such as age and sex. The dependent variable is often denoted by Y, refers to the effect or the outcome variables. And the term regression refers to the mathematical relationship between the dependent and the independent variables. In a simple linear regression, we have one independent or X and one dependent or Y variable. The type of regression, whether linear or logistic, is determined by Y. If Y is continuous, the type of regression is linear. And X in any kind of regression can either be categorical or continuous. The equation for simple linear regression is denoted by Y equals beta naught plus beta 1 times X, where beta 1 is the slope and beta naught is the y-intercept. As an example, if we are trying to study the effect of age on blood pressure, age will be our independent variable, whereas blood pressure will be our dependent variable. And we know from practical experience that the blood pressure goes up with age. The biggest and the most high-yield disadvantage of simple linear regression is that confounders are often not accounted for. So from the previous example, BMI and smoking status can confound the results of the previous regression. In multiple linear regression, we have multiple independent or X variables and one Y or dependent variable. The biggest advantage of multiple linear regression is that we can adjust for possible confounders. The equation for multiple linear regression is often given by Y equals the intercept plus the X or the independent variables multiplied by their respective slopes, so the beta 1 x1, beta 2 for x2, and beta 3 for x3. An example of multiple linear regression would be trying to study the effects of age, BMI, and smoking status on blood pressure. And we know blood pressure is continuous, and thus it'll be a multiple linear regression. With logistic regression, the Y or the dependent variable must be categorical or dichotomous. And again, the X can either be categorical or continuous. In a simple logistic regression, we have one X and one Y variable. In multiple logistic regression, we have multiple X and one Y variable. As an example for a multiple logistic regression, if we are trying to study the effect of age, sex, BMI, and blood sugar, which are our X variables, on the presence or absence of diabetes, which would be our dichotomous Y variable. Again, the biggest advantage with multiple logistic regression as opposed to simple logistic regression is that we can account for confounders in multiple logistic regression. You have reached the end of this module. Thank you so much for bearing with me. Stay well and see you in the next module.